knowledge, I and those who follow me. How great is this ayah, the Sheikh mentioned. And it's befitting for all of us to contemplate upon this ayah and to understand its meanings and to make this ayah a light for us that we use to traverse the path of the Salaf.
أيها الإخوة والأخوات، ربنا سبحانه وتعالى بعث محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم بالهدى المبين وجعله رحمة للعالمين، كما قال سبحانه: وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. فهو صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة مهدى، كل ما جاء به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة للعالمين. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة للإنس أجمعين ورحمة للجن أجمعين، رحمة للمؤمنين ورحمة للكافرين. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة عامة للناس أجمعين، لمؤمنهم وكافرهم، ورحمة عامة من جهتين: الجهة الأولى أن الأرض ببعثته صلى الله عليه وسلم أمنت من العذاب العام الذي يصيب أهلها، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان في بعثته أمنة لأهل الأرض أجمعين من عذاب عام يحصد أهل الأرض. والجهة الثانية هو صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة للعالمين ببيانه: فما ترك خيرا إلا دل الناس عليه لو كانوا يعقلون، وما ترك شرا إلا حذر الناس منه لو كانوا يعقلون. وهذا الذي جاء به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم للناس أجمعين فيه حفظ مصالحهم، فيه حفظ دينهم، فيه حفظ أنفسهم، فيه حفظ أنسابهم، فيه حفظ عقولهم، فيه حفظ أموالهم، فيه الرحمة والمصلحة التامة للناس أجمعين. وهو رحمة لمن آمن به فوق رحمته للناس أجمعين بما جاء به صلى الله عليه وسلم وبكونه أسوة للمؤمنين، وأن من سار على طريقه اهتدى، فالخير كله في طريقه، والاستقامة لا تكون إلا بالسير خلفه صلى الله عليه وسلم. ومن هنا كان واجبا على المؤمن أن يعرف طريق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أن يعرف سبيل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهو ما جاء في هذه الآية الكريمة العظيمة، آية واحدة لخصت طريق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And the Sheikh حفظه الله تعالى, he continued and he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by sending our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the guidance, he made him a mercy for the alameen. He made him a mercy for all of mankind and jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He said that we have not sent you, O Muhammad, except as a mercy for the alameen. He is a mercy that has been gifted to us. And everything that he has come with is a mercy for the alameen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he is a mercy for all mankind, and he is a mercy for the jinn. He is a mercy for the believers, and he is also a mercy for the disbelievers. He is an encompassing rahmah for everyone, believers and disbelievers. And he is a mercy to everyone from two angles. The first angle is that by sending him and by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending him to us, all of the people on earth have become safe and secure from the punishment. The punishment, al-adab al-am, the punishment that would encompass everyone for their sins. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not destroy all the people, and he would not afflict them with a general punishment as long as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was amongst them. So he was a peace and security for all of mankind. Likewise, he's also a mercy for everyone from another angle. That's the angle that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a mercy to everyone by way of his clarification of the straight path and the truth. There is no good except that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam has clarified it to us. And there's no evil except that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam has warned us from it. He's left no evil except warning us from that evil. So in his guidance, there's a protection for the people's masalih, their needs. There's a protection for their religion. There's a protection for their intellects, for their wealth. In his guidance, there is a mercy and maslaha, a complete benefit for everyone. He, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, on top of being a mercy specifically for the believers, likewise, he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is a mercy for the believers more specifically, because of the fact that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a role model for the believers that they follow. All good is in his way, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Al-istiqamah and uprightness is in following his path. And it is because of this that it is obligatory upon every believer to know his way, the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this verse, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِ أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, it has summarized. It has summarized the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that we should follow. Now,
Allah Azza wa Jal يأمر نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يقول هذه المقولة العظيمة: قل هذه سبيلي. فربنا سبحانه وتعالى يقول لنا: هذا سبيل رسولي لمن أراد أن يسلكه، فهل أنتم سالكون؟ ونبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لنا بأمر ربه: هذا سبيلي فهل أنتم مهتدون؟ لكن ما سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الذي بين في هذه الآية؟ قال بعض العلماء: سبيلي يعني ديني. قل هذا ديني وهذه معالمه. وقال بعض أهل العلم: يعني دعوتي، فدعوتي دعوة رحمة، دعوة هداية تحمل الخير للناس أجمعين. وقال بعض أهل العلم: سبيلي يعني سنتي، أي طريقي الذي أسلكه في ديني. وقال بعض أهل العلم: سبيلي يعني منهاجي، هذا منهجي الذي أسير عليه. وكلها صحيحة، فكلها سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، دينه، سنته، دعوته، منهجه صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذه الآية. فمن أراد ملخص دين رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فهو في هذه الآية، ومن أراد ملخص سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فهو في هذه الآية، ومن أراد ملخص منهج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في دعوته فهو في هذه الآية. وهذا يجعل المؤمن يعظم هذه الآية تعظيما كبيرا، ويتدبرها ليكون من أهلها.
الشيخ حفظه الله continued and he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, is commanding his messenger to proclaim to us this great statement. So it is as if our Lord is saying to us, this is the path of my messenger. So whoever, this is the path of my messenger for whoever wants to follow it. So are you going to follow this path? And it is as if our messenger, our prophet, is saying to us, this is my path. So who is going to follow this path? The question is, what is his path, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Some of the scholars, they mentioned, sabili means dini, that this is my religion. Other scholars, they mentioned, what's meant by sabili is da'wati, this is my call. And his call is a call of mercy and guidance. There are other scholars that have mentioned that sabili means sunnati. This is my sunnah, this is my way. This is the way that I follow. Likewise, some of the scholars, they mentioned that sabili means minhaji. This is my methodology. This is the methodology and the path that I followed to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh mentioned that all of these meanings are correct. All of them. All of them are from the path of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whoever wants to acquire a summary of the religion of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it is to be found in this verse. Whoever wants to find a summary of the da'wah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you'll find it in this verse. Likewise, whoever wants to have a summary of the manhaj of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you'll find a summary of his manhaj in this verse. So this truly makes the believer, or allows the believer, to give great importance to this ayah. Great importance to this ayah, and understanding its meanings and contemplating on it.
أدعو إلى الله، هذا المعلم الأول من معالم سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أدعو إلى الله وأدعو لله. أدعو إلى الله وأدعو لله، وما أعظمه من شرف أن يكون الإنسان داعيا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى، كما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم داعيا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. وكيف لا يكون الشرف في ذلك والذي يدعو إلى الله عز وجل حاله أحسن الأحوال وقوله أصدق الأقوال. الذي يدعو إلى الله حاله أحسن الأحوال وقوله أصدق الأقوال. قال ربنا سبحانه وتعالى: ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله. لا أحد، لا أحد أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله، أدعو إلى توحيد الله، أدعو إلى عبادة الله، أدعو إلى حسن السير إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. والداعية إلى الله لا بد أن يكون موحدا، إذن هو موحد يدعو إلى التوحيد، يدعو إلى عبادة ربه سبحانه وتعالى. وأدعو لله، فقصدي من الدعوة أن أرضي الله، قصدي من دعوتي وجه الله، فأنا مخلص في دعوتي، أدعو إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. فالداعية المحمود الممدوح هو الذي يخلص في دعوته إلى الله، فهو يدعو لله، يدعو لأن الله أراد هذا شرعا، لا يدعو لنفسه. وهل يمكن أن يدعو الإنسان لنفسه؟ نعم، بعض الناس يدعون لأنفسهم، يريدون الشهرة، يريدون الجماهيرية، يريدون أن يقبل عليهم الناس، ولذلك يزينون للناس ولا يدعون الناس إلى الحق، يعطون الناس ما يريدون لا ما يريده الله سبحانه وتعالى. ولذلك يا إخوة، الذي يدعو لله ينظر للناس بالشرع، فيدعوهم إلى ما يصلحهم ولو لم يرضهم، يدعوهم إلى التوحيد وإن كانوا لا يحبون هذه الدعوة، يدعوهم إلى السنة وإن كانوا لا يحبون هذه الدعوة، ينظر إلى الناس بميزان الشرع. وهكذا كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عندما جاء يدعو قومه دعا إلى التوحيد، وما كان قومه يريدون التوحيد وأنكروا دعوته، لكنه صلى الله عليه وسلم ظل يدعوهم إلى التوحيد ولم يغير دعوته من أجلهم. أما بعض الناس فإنه ينظر إلى الشرع بعيون الناس، ماذا يريد الناس؟ ماذا يريد الناس؟ يريدون كذا يدعو إليه، لا يريدون كذا لا يدعو إليه، هذا لا يدعو لله، هذا يدعو لنفسه. لا يدعو الداعية الذي يستحق اسم الداعية شرعا، لا يدعو إلى شيخ بعينه ينصبه للناس يعقد عليه الولاء والبراء، وإنما يدعو إلى الحق الذي مع الشيخ. والناس قد يخطئون ويصيبون، والحق معلوم بدليله، فهو ينصر الدليل ويدعو للدليل، ويعظم الناس بمقدار ما عندهم من الحق. إذن هذا المعلم العظيم يدعو إلى الله ويدعو لله، وهذا أول معالم سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
الشيخ حفظ الله تعالى، he continued and he said regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's statement أدعو إلى الله، I call to Allah. And this is the first milestone from the milestones of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's way when it comes to da'wah. Ad'u ila Allah, I call to Allah, and ad'u lillah, I call for the sake of Allah. And what sharaf and honor is greater than the honor of the one who calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? For indeed, whoever calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his status and his honor is that he is in the best of states, and his statements are the most truthful of statements. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in statement than the one who says, who is better in statement than the one who calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and does righteous good deeds, and he says that I am from those who have submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. I am from the Muslimin. No one is better in statement than this individual. Ad'u ila Allah, I call to Allah, i.e. I call to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the monotheism of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and singling him out in worship. Ad'u ila ibadatillah, I call to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I call to the way of the best way to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who is a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he has to call to tawheed. He has to be someone who calls to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has to be someone who calls to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, without associating any partners with him in worship. So the Shaykh mentioned that the reason or the qasd or the objective of giving da'wah has to be ikhlas, has to be sincerity. So the person who is calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is praiseworthy, he is the one who has sincerity in his da'wah, who is calling to the people, who is calling the people to Allah for the sake of Allah. And he is calling the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and whatever he calls to, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that. He doesn't call to himself. And is it possible that someone gives da'wah and calls to Allah, but in reality he is calling to himself? Is that possible? Yes, this is possible. This is possible. It is possible that he is calling for the sake of gaining fame, or gaining a majority, or gaining a large following. He gives the people, when it comes to da'wah, he gives them what they want. Because for him, it's about the people. It's about gaining their interest. But the one who has ikhlas in his da'wah, who is sincere in his da'wah, then he calls the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the lens of the sharia. Through the lens of the sharia. So he calls them to tawheed even if they don't want to be called to tawheed. And he calls them to the sunnah and holding on to the sunnah even if that doesn't interest the people. And this is how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to be. He would call his people to tawheed, Quraysh, but they didn't want tawheed. They didn't want to hear tawheed. But nevertheless, this is what he called them to. Why? Because this is what they needed. So he gives the people and he calls the people to what they need, not what they want. Some people, that's what they do. They look at the people when they give da'wah, and their objective is, what do the people want? They look at what they want. Such an individual is not calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is not a person who's calling to the haqq. Likewise, some people, they call to a particular shaykh And they make that individual the objective of their da'wah, calling to a specific shaykh or a specific individual. And based on that da'wah, they have allegiance and disallegiance. The shaykh said, no, the truthful one is the one who calls to the people to the truth that is with that shaykh. That he doesn't connect the people to the shaykh. He calls the people to the truth and to the proofs, not individuals. And he gives importance to people in his eyes in accordance to the truth that is with them. Now,
على بصيرة هذا المعلم الثاني من معالم سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فما معنى على بصيرة؟ معناها على يقين بلا شك وبعلم بلا جهل. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يدعو إلى الله بعلم علمه الله إياه بالوحي، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما ينطق بالوحي، وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. إذن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يدعو إلى الله بالوحي، هذا العلم، بالوحي، بالقرآن، بالسنة التي آتاها الله للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. وهكذا الداعية الشرعي الذي يحمد ويمدح يدعو إلى الله بالعلم. ما هو العلم؟ ما في الكتاب والسنة، فيدعو بالقرآن ويدعو بسنة سيد ولد عدنان صلى الله عليه وسلم، وبيقين لا شك فيه، فهو على يقين من الحق، على يقين مما يدعو إليه، لا يشك في ذلك، لا تزلزله الأهواء ولا تغيره الآراء، لا يتقلب يوما يمينا ويوما شمالا، يوما ينكر ويوما يعرف، وإنما على يقين، لأنه لا يأخذ من متقلب، وإنما يأخذ من ثابت من كتاب الله ومن سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بفهم سلف الأمة. إذن على بصيرة، على علم ينافي الجهل، على بيقين ينافي الشك، وهذا معلم سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى, he went on to the second part of the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says على بصيرة, upon sure knowledge. This is the second milestone from the milestones of the da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So what does basira mean? What's the meaning of basira? Basira means that you call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon yaqeen, upon certainty, without any doubt. And that you call with knowledge and not with jahl, ignorance. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught him through the revelation. So the messenger wouldn't talk out of desires, rather he would speak by way of revelation. So the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would call to Allah by way of wahi, revelation, by way of knowledge, and by way of sunnah. And that is how the da'i or the caller to Allah should be. He should call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with knowledge. So what is knowledge? Knowledge is that which is to be found in the Kitab and the Sunnah, in the Book of Allah and in the Sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with yaqeen and without any doubt. So the caller to Allah, he is upon certainty. He's upon certainty. He is not shaked by the ahwa or the different desires. He doesn't change colors. He doesn't change from day to day. Today he calls to this and tomorrow he calls to that. No. He doesn't go left. He doesn't go right. He is thabit. He is firm. Why is he firm? Because he is taking from something that is set in stone, something that is firm. He's taking from the Quran and the Sunnah and the path of the Salaf. He is not taking, his source that he's taking from is not a source that changes. It's a source that is firm and it's a source that is permanent that doesn't change. So based on that, the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that calls with knowledge, then he is firm upon that which he calls to. So he calls with knowledge, which excludes any types of ignorance. And he calls with yaqeen, with certainty, which excludes all types of shak and uncertainty or doubts.
أنا ومن اتبعني. الله أكبر. هذه سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهذه معالمها وهي سبيل من اتبع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والذين اتبعوا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حين نزول الآية هم صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذن هذا سبيل صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وطريق صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ومنهج صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يخرج عنه أحد منهم وكذلك من اتبعهم بإحسان هذه سبيله وهذه طريقه إذن يوزن الناس بهذه الآية كما سيأتي بيانه في آخر الكلام إن شاء الله عز وجل.
And the third part of the ayah mentions أنا ومن اتبعني, I and those that follow me. This is the path of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is also the path of those who follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahu Akbar. And the Shaykh said those that followed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when this verse was revealed were the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this in reality is the path of the Prophet, of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is their path, this is their manhaj, and this is their way. And this path of theirs, none of the companions of the Messenger have strayed from this path. All of them were united upon this path. And likewise those who follow the companions of the Messenger with ihsan upon goodness. Likewise, they follow this path. Therefore, this verse, you can use this verse to put the people on a scale. You can use this verse to put the people on a scale to see who is following the path of the Messenger and who is not. As the Sheikh mentioned, we will clarify towards the end of today's talk.
وسبحانالله هذا المعلم الثالث من معالم سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسبيل صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسبيل المتبعين لهم بإحسان أي أنزه الله وأدعو إلى تنزيه الله عن كل ما لا يليق بجلاله سبحانه وتعالى أنزه الله عن الشرك وأدعو وأحب إلى ترك الشرك وأحذر من الشرك، أنزه الله عن تعطيل أسمائه وصفاته، أنزه الله عن تحريف أسمائه وصفاته، أنزه الله عن كل ما لا يليق بجلاله. فدعوتي دعوة لتنزيه ربي سبحانه وتعالى، وما أنا من المشركين. هذا المعلم الرابع لسبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فلست من المشركين وليسوا مني. فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس من المشركين، والمشركون ليسوا منه، بل له دينه صلى الله عليه وسلم ولهم دينهم، لكنه يدعوهم إلى التوحيد لأنه على الحق وهم على الباطل. فهذا معلم عظيم. وانظر كيف بدأ السبيل بالدعوة إلى التوحيد، وختم السبيل بالتحذير من الشرك. فسبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وصحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكل داعية شرعي لا بد فيه من الدعوة إلى التوحيد والتحذير من الشرك.
The Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى, he continued regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's statement, wa subhanallah and glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh mentioned that this is the third milestone from the milestones of the path of our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions and those that follow them upon goodness. It is to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and free Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from everything that's not suitable to our Lord. So we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we free him from all types of shirk. Likewise, we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and free him from denying and rejecting his perfect names and attributes. Likewise, we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and free him from changing the meanings of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, distorting their meanings, at-tahrif. We also glorify Allah from that. So our da'wah is a da'wah of glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all of that which does not suit him. And the final part of the ayah says, وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, and I am not from those who are al-mushrikeen, those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. And this is the fourth milestone from the milestones of the path of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I am not from the mushrikeen, and neither are they from me. Rather, I have my religion and they have their religion. At the same time, I call them to tawheed, because I am upon truth and they are upon falsehood. So the Shaykh said, contemplate on how this path in this ayah started with the calling to tawheed. The ayah started with ad'u ila Allah, calling to tawheed. And the ayah finished with warning against shirk. Warning against shirk. And this is the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions and those that follow them upon goodness, is that they call to tawheed and they warn against shirk.
إذن معالم منهج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، معالم منهج الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم، معالم منهج كل متبع لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يدعو إلى الله وأن يكون في دعوته على بصيرة، على علم ويقين، وأن تكون دعوته لتنزيه الله عما لا يليق بجلاله، وأن لا يكون من المشركين، وأن لا يكون مع أهل الانحراف من البدع والمعاصي وغيرها. وهذه المعالم يا إخوة ميزان نزن به كل دعوة، ونزن به كل إنسان. فمن جاءنا بمنهج، من جاءنا بطريقة في الدعوة، عرضناه على هذه المعالم. فإن وجدنا أن على رأس دعوته أن يدعو إلى التوحيد على وجه التفصيل، وأن يحذر من الشرك على وجه التفصيل، نظرنا فيما بقي. وإن وجدنا أن دعوته لا تهتم بالتوحيد ولا يحذر من الشرك ويزعم أن الدعوة إلى التوحيد تفرق الناس وتنفر الناس من الحق وتنفر الناس من الدين، عرفنا أن دعوته ليست شرعية وليست صحيحة وليست رشيدة، وأبطلنا منهجه وقلنا هذه بدعة. لماذا؟ لأنها تخالف سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وتخالف سبيل من اتبع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. نقول له: أنت على بدعة، لم تسر على طريقة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولم تكن متبعا لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. إن وجدنا أنه يدعو إلى الله على علم، فهو لا يدعو بجهل، لا يقوم أمام الناس وهو لا يدري شيئا ويدعوهم ويسمونه داعية ويقولون افتح فمك يفتح الله عليك، ثم يأتي يقف أمام الناس في المسجد يقول إنه داعية، ما يدعو بعلم، وإنما أنا كنت أشرب الخمر وكنت أرقص مع النساء وكنت أسمع الموسيقى وكنت أفعل وكنت والله يا جماعة حصل كذا وحصل كذا. هذا ليس بداعية شرعي، وهذه ليست دعوة صحيحة، وهذه ليست دعوة شرعية، وهذه ليست دعوة رشيدة، لأن هذا المعلم على بصيرة ليس موجودا فيها. إن وجدنا أنه في دعوته ينزه الله عن كل ما لا يليق بجلاله، عرفنا أنها دعوة رشيدة. أما إذا وجدنا أنه لا يهتم بتوحيد الأسماء والصفات، ولا يهتم بالتحذير من الشرك، ولا يهتم بالتحذير من المنكرات، عرفنا أن دعوته ليست رشيدة وليست شرعية وليست صحيحة وليست ناجحة. وإذا وجدنا أنه لا يهتم بالتحذير من الشرك والبعد عن المشركين وعن أهل الأهواء والبدع، عرفنا أن دعوته ليست صحيحة وليست رشيدة. هذا الميزان يا إخوة، وهو ميزان واضح، من سار عليه فهو متبع لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وحتى أنت زن نفسك بهذه الآية، هل أنت موحد؟ هل أنت معظم للتوحيد؟ هل تدعو إلى التوحيد إن استطعت؟ هل تطلب العلم وتحب العلم؟ هل تنزه الله عن كل ما لا يليق بجلاله؟ هل تحرص على أن تكون مع أهل السنة، مع أهل الهدى والتقى، وأن تفارق أهل الباطل؟ إن وجدت ذلك فاعلم أنك على سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن وجدت غير ذلك فصحح طريقك وارجع إلى هذه الطريق.
So the Shaykh, he mentioned that these are the milestones of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions and those that follow him when it comes to da'wah. It is that they call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that this call should be upon basirah, upon knowledge and certainty, and that it should be a call to glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that they should not be from the mushrikeen, those who associate partners with Allah in worship, and that they should not be with the people of misguidance, from the people of innovation and desires. So the Shaykh mentioned this is a scale that we use to measure any da'wah. Anyone that calls to Allah, that claims to call to Allah, we use this as a scale to measure their da'wah. If we find that that individual calls to Tawheed and that he warns against shirk and that this is his main call, this is the thing that he focuses on, then the Shaykh said we will look at everything else. If these two things are to be found, then we will look at the other things. However, if we find that he doesn't call to Tawheed, he doesn't give importance to calling to the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he claims that according to Tawheed, it makes the people run away. It puts people off. It causes division. If this is his state, then the Shaykh said, then we know automatically that his da'wah is not a da'wah that is correct, because it opposes the da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions. Likewise, and we say to such an individual that you are upon innovation, because your path is different from the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions. And the Shaykh said, if we find someone who calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with knowledge, and he doesn't speak with ignorance, and he's not from those people that say, iftah famak yaftah Allah alayk, just open your mouth and Allah will open the doors for you in da'wah, just start talking. And we find such people, they sit down and they just talk. I used to do this, I used to drink alcohol, and I used to dance with women, I used to do X, Y, and Z, and then this happened, and Allah guided me like this, and they talk without knowledge, ignorance. They don't bring knowledge to the table. Then we know that this da'wah is not a correct da'wah. Why? Because it's not based on knowledge. The da'wah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions is based on knowledge. But those individuals who call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge, we know that their da'wah is incorrect. And we know that their da'wah is misguided. Why? Because they opposed this milestone. They opposed this principle, which is ala basira, calling to Allah upon sure knowledge. This milestone is not to be found in their da'wah. So their da'wah is incorrect. Likewise, if you find that someone that he calls to the glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his da'wah is correct. But if you find someone who he doesn't focus on calling to the glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. he doesn't focus on teaching the people about the perfect names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from anything that doesn't suit him, establishing his perfect names and attributes, if you find that someone is upon that state, then you know his path is incorrect. Why? Because one of the milestones or one of the principles was that subhanallah, to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's one of the milestones. Likewise, if you find someone calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he doesn't warn against shirk, he doesn't warn against innovations, he doesn't warn against misguidance, then likewise we know that such an individual, his call is incorrect. Because the last milestone was, وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, and I'm not with those or from those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This, my dear brothers and sisters, is our mizan. This is the measurement that we use. And it is clear. It's a clear mizan. It's not ambiguous. It's very clear. And whoever follows this path and implements these principles, then he is someone who's upon the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Shaykh also said, it's not only measuring other people, even yourself. You have to measure yourself and your state. Are you someone who is muwahhid? Are you someone who's upon tawheed? Are you someone who calls to tawheed? Your own call, are you someone who calls to tawheed? Are you someone who loves knowledge and is eager to seek knowledge? Are you someone who glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and establishes His perfect names and attributes? Are you someone who loves Ahlul Sunnah and hates the people of misguidance and shirk and is free from them? You have to hold yourself to account. Now.
وَمِنْ هَذَا السَّبِيلِ الْعَظِيمِ الَّذِي هُوَ سَبِيلُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ ما جاء في قول ربنا سبحانه وتعالى فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك فاعف عنهم واستغفر لهم وشاورهم في الأمر فإذا عزمت فتوكل على الله إن الله يحب المتوكلين. هذا من سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يكون الإنسان في دعوته، في دعوته لأهله، في دعوته لجيرانه، في دعوته للناس منطلقا من الرحمة، فهو يدعوهم لأنه يرحمهم ويظهر له ويظهر لهم أنه يرحمهم، كما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يفعل ويكون لينا في دعوته، أن يكون لين القلب، لين اللسان، طيب الكلام في دعوته الناس، مبتعدا عن الغلظة والجلافة والقسوة ما أمكنه ذلك. لأن الله عز وجل يقول لرسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. الفظ الغليظ لا يستطيع الناس أن يصبروا عليه ولو كان عنده خير. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الله له ذلك ولو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. إذن الداعية ينبغي أن يبتعد عن الغلظة، أن يبتعد عن القسوة ما دام مستطيعا، إلا إذا احتاج الأمر إلى شيء من الغلظة، فهذا أمر مستثنى. وذلك أجمل مثال لهذا ذكره شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله، ذكر مثالا لمسألة اللين والغلظة، وأن الأصل اللين، ولكن قد يحتاج الداعية إلى شيء من الغلظة للحاجة. قال: المؤمن للمؤمن كاليدين، بمعنى يا إخوة المؤمن محتاج إلى أخيه المؤمن أن يدعوه، أن يذكره، أن يعظه. اليد الواحدة ما تستطيع أن تغسل نفسها، لكن باليد الثانية تغسل إحداهما الأخرى. المسلم للمسلم كاليدين، تغسل إحداهما الأخرى. والأصل أن الإنسان يغسل يديه برفق، لكن انظر ماذا قال: وقد يحتاج الوسخ إلى شيء من الدلك. أحيانا تأكل شيئا فيه شحم، فيه سمن، فيه كذا، فيبقى في اليد، إذا غسلت برفق ما يزول، فتحتاج أن تدلك بقوة. وهكذا أنت مع المؤمن ومع الناس في دعوتك، تدعو بلين ورفق وطيب، لكن أحيانا قد تحتاج إلى شيء من الغلظة وتضعها في موضعها.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى continued and he said, and from this great way, from the way of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is in accordance to the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Because of the mercy from your Lord to you, O Muhammad, you are soft to them. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. And if you were someone who is harsh with them, i.e. your companions, then they would have run away from you. So the Shaykh mentioned that this is from the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam when it comes to da'wah. So it's upon the da'i that calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his da'wah, when he calls the people, first and foremost when he calls his own family, when he calls his neighbors, or all of the people, anyone that he calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's upon him to employ mercy. That he calls them with mercy. First, he calls them out of mercy. Because of his mercy for them, he is calling them to Allah. But also that he shows the mercy in his call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he calls the people with mercy by being very soft in the way that he speaks with them. And he stays away from harshness in speech. And the Muslim or the da'i should stay away from all types of harshness to the best of his ability. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his own Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if you were harsh with your companions, then they would have left you. Shaykh mentioned that the person who is harsh with the people, then people can't be patient with, they can't be patient and they won't stay with him. Even if he has a lot of good with him. Even if he has a lot of good with him, he's calling to Tawheed, he's calling to Sunnah. If he is harsh and he employs harshness in his da'wah, people will not have patience with him. So the person should stay away from harshness to the best of his ability, except if in a specific situation, harshness is required. But this is not the default. The default is that you are soft. The default is that you show people mercy. However, there are situations whereby you need to employ a level of harshness. And the most beautiful example that has been given by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, where he talked about this. And he said that the believer is to his brother, the other believer, they are like two hands. They are like two hands. The first thing we benefit from this is that the believer needs his brother. The believer needs his brother. Why? Because when you want to wash your hands, one hand can't wash itself. You need the other hand. The two hands need each other to wash each other. However, the Shaykh mentioned that the asal or the default is that when you wash your hands, you do so with softness. You don't employ harshness. However, there might be a situation because of the dirt on your hand, the grease on your hand, where you have to apply some level of harshness and force in order to get rid of the dirt. But that's not always the case. Depends on the situation. So the Shaykh mentioned this is the best example that has been given when it comes to when and how a believer should employ softness and harshness with his brother. And that is how every believer should be with his Muslim brother.
فَاعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ. الله أكبر. ما أحوج الناس عموما وأحوج الدعاء خصوصا إلى هذا الطريق. فاعف عنهم أي عما يخطئون في حقك، واستغفر لهم أي فيما يقعون فيه من الذنوب. إذن يا إخوة، العفو فيما يتعلق بحق الإنسان، والاستغفار أن تستغفر لهم فيما يتعلق بحق الله. الداعية يجب عليه أن يعلم أن إخوانه ومن يدعوهم إلى الله يخطئون، قد يخطئون عليه ويقول أحدهم كلاما فيه، ينبغي أن يعفو لهم يعفو عنهم ما استطاع، ويعلم أن البشر خطاؤون يقعون في الذنوب، فيستغفر الله لهم. وشاورهم في الأمر. الدعاء بحاجة إلى المشاورة. لا ينبغي لأحد أن يجعل نفسه فوق الجميع، يرجع إليه الجميع، بل ينبغي أن يكون الأمر شورى. الدعاة في البلد، دعاة السنة، يتشاورون، ويشير بعضهم على بعض، وينصح بعضهم بعضا. فإذا ظهر الحق وبان النور فتوكل على الله، وافعل ما ظهر أنه الحق، واثبت عليه وسر عليه. هذا من سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ونحن بحاجة عظيمة لأن نقتفي أثر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذا. ووالله ثم والله ثم والله يا إخوة، لو طبقنا هذا السبيل واقتفينا أثر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لذهبت أكثر المشاكل التي نراها في الساحة اليوم، بل وأكثر المشاكل في البيوت تذهب لو طبق هذا السبيل وسرنا على هذا السبيل.
Sheikh Hafizullah Ta'ala mentioned the continuation of the ayah, the previous ayah we mentioned, فَاعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ إِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. فَاعْفُ عَنْهُمْ, overlook them, overlook their mistakes. This relates to the fact that you have to know as a da'i that people, they will make mistakes when it comes to your rights. They'll make mistakes. You need to overlook those mistakes. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ, and seek forgiveness for them. And this relates to the sins that one might commit when it comes to the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, al-afu, fa'afu anhum, the first part, it relates to your rights. People, they will make mistakes when it comes to your rights. You have to pardon them, overlook them. وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ, and when it comes to their sins, and all Bani Adam is khata, and everyone will fall into sins, then what you should do is you should seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your brothers and your sisters. Because they will make mistakes. So everyone will make a mistake in your right, and everyone will fall into sins. So this is what we should do. Overlook and pardon, and seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our brothers and sisters. وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ, and seek their counsel in your affairs. Seek advice from one another. The Shaykh mentioned that the callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are in need of counsel. They are in need of seeking advice from one another. And it shouldn't be that one of them is placed above everyone else, that everyone else has to return back to that one person. No. Rather, the Shaykh mentioned, وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنَهُمْ, like Allah said in another surah, that their affair between them is that they seek each other's advice and they have counsel. No one is above another and no one is a reference point for everyone else. وَشَاوِرُهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ فَإِذَا عَزِمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. The Shaykh mentioned that when the truth becomes clear in a matter, then Allah says, فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Put your trust in Allah and pursue it. Put your trust in Allah and pursue the truth. And the Shaykh, he concluded by saying that, وَاللَّهِ, the name of Allah, ثُمَّ وَاللَّهِ, if we implemented this ayah and we followed this path, then indeed all of the problems that we see today would go away. All of the problems we see today in the saha to do with da'wah and the issues that we see, all of it will go away. Most of it will go away. Even within our own households, if we were to implement this ayah in our own households, the Shaykh said most of the problems that we have, they would go away. If we follow the path of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as outlined in this ayah, then all these problems would disappear.
هذا ما أردت طرحه وبيانه في هذا المجلس. أسأل الله عز وجل أن يجعلنا ممن يقتفون سبيل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ونتوقف هنا للراحة كما ذكر الإخوة في الجدول. وإن شاء الله الساعة 4:30 نبدأ المجلس الثاني، وأرجو من الإخوة أن يحرصوا على الحضور يعني في الوقت حتى نبدأ في الوقت إن شاء الله ونغتنم هذا الوقت. وإن شاء الله سيكون المجلس التالي والذي بعده في أمر ذي أهمية كبرى، حيث سنتكلم عن أصول في معاملة الخلق، كيف يعامل الخلق بعضهم معاملة رشيدة شرعية. هذا إن شاء الله ما سنطرحه في المجلسين التاليين. وفق الله الجميع، وصلى الله على نبينا وسلم.
Sheikh concluded by saying, this is what I wanted to present to you today and clarify, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes us from those who follow the path of our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I will stop here. And the Shaykh said we will continue with the next talk at 4:30 p.m. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll take a break. The Shaykh advised everyone to be on time and not to be late. And the Shaykh said we will be talking about a very important topic which relates to principles when it comes to dealing with the creation. Principles when it comes to dealing with people. How do we deal with people? هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد.
بارك الله فيك. جزاكم الله خيرا.